Hi, I am Dr. Gudmundsson. This video is intended for my students in my aircraft design class at Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University, where I currently teach. The video presents excerpts from my textbook, General Aviation Aircraft Design, Applied Methods and Procedures. Its purpose is to supplement my class lectures. The book is available online from a large number of outlets, for instance Elsevier and Amazon. It is recommended for anyone interested in the design of general aviation aircraft. This video will show you how to calculate the position of your aircraft's center of gravity, often just called the CG. The material presented is detailed in Chapter 6 in my book. Note that I will use the term CG frequently, and when I do, I am referring to the position of the center of gravity of the aircraft in three-dimensional space. At the end of the video, you should be able to calculate this position and distinguish between the different kinds of CG positions. Knowing the position of the CG is vital in many areas of aircraft design, for instance stability and control and structure analysis. Let's begin by reviewing a few definitions. The term center of mass refers to a point in space at which the mass of an object can be considered concentrated. The center of mass of an object is the same as its center of gravity, as long as we are in a constant acceleration field, such as that of our wonderful planet. Therefore, here on Earth, the terms center of mass and center of gravity are interchangeable. In the calculations that follow, it is important to remember that the term mass refers to an amount of matter. The term weight, on the other hand, refers to the force that this amount of matter develops when subjected to gravitational acceleration. When considering weight in terms of the SI system, we are actually referring to mass. Thus, when we state an aircraft weighs, say, 2,500 kilograms or kilos, or a person weighs 75 kilos, we are really stating the mass. Of course, the unit for force in the SI system is Newton. It is important not to be confused by this erroneous use of these terms. In contrast, the use of the UK system, also known as the US customary units, involves stating the weight of aircraft, baggage, and people in terms of pound force. Note that I recommend the subscript F for clarity when distinguishing between pound mass and pound force. The term pound mass is not really used in either the UK or US customary systems. Instead, mass is specified in terms of slugs. Regardless, denoting pound force in this fashion is important to design and certification documentation, especially when such documents are considered in liability cases, where any omission is used to support notions of negligence. It is important for aspiring engineers to recognize that many of the documents they produce in their careers will be reviewed by non-engineering personnel, including sales and marketing, administration, and of course lawyers. Let's now define a few concepts pertaining to weight analysis as defined in section 6.1 in my book. Empty weight is the weight of an aircraft without any useful load. However, the weight of oil, unusable fuel, and hydraulic fluid is normally considered a part of the empty weight. Design gross weight is the maximum takeoff weight for the mission for which the airplane is designed. Useful load is defined as the difference between the design gross weight and the empty weight. It is the weight of everything the aircraft will carry beside its own weight. This typically includes occupants, fuel, and freight. The term payload has a strict meaning in aircraft design. It refers only to the part of the useful load that yields revenue for the operator. Typically, it is the passengers and freight. Crew members operating the aircraft, as well as oil and fuel, are not a part of the payload. A good rule of thumb for distinguishing payload from other components of the useful load is to ask, does said weight pay for the ride? As an example, fuel or pilots and flight attendants do not pay for the ride. Therefore, their weight is not a part of the payload. Passengers, on the other hand, do. Therefore, they are part of the payload. Crew weight refers to the weight of occupants required to operate the aircraft. This includes both pilots and cabin crew when present. Fuel weight is the weight of the fuel required to complete the design mission. It also includes the legally required reserve fuel. It is of importance to remember that the operation of aircraft differs in great many ways from that of the family sedan. There are not too many cars around that can't carry full occupant load with full fuel tank. Of course, cars are not nearly as sensitive to weight as aircraft. And it is true that most airplanes will exceed their maximum takeoff weight with full tanks of fuel and all seats occupied. This means that on a day when the airplane is carrying full passenger load, the fuel tanks cannot be filled up, and therefore the range and endurance of that mission is reduced, often substantially. Next, let's define a few concepts that involve the position of the CG. The term CG envelope refers to an imaginary frame inside which the CG must reside at all times during flight. As an example, here is the CG envelope for the Cessna 182, and here for the Airbus 330. The empty weight CG refers to the position of the CG when the airplane is at its empty weight. This position can largely be considered constant, although it can change as a consequence of new equipment being installed in the airplane. The empty weight CG may or may not be inside the CG envelope, but if so, it must move inside the envelope when loaded for flight. Operational CG refers to the position of the CG when the aircraft is loaded for a given mission. Unlike the empty weight CG, the operational CG is usually different from flight to flight. This is particularly so for passenger and cargo aircraft. A passenger aircraft may have every seat filled on one flight, and a few passengers on the next one. This naturally results in two different CG positions. Furthermore, the operational CG of fossil-fueled aircraft changes during flight due to fuel burn. This is important to keep in mind because it is possible to load the airplane such it will burn itself out of the CG envelope in flight. It is the responsibility of the pilot to ensure the CG of the airplane resides inside the CG envelope before takeoff. However, it is the responsibility of the aircraft design team to develop a CG envelope that makes it next to impossible to burn oneself out of it if the airplane has been loaded properly before takeoff. Now let's deal with how the CG position is calculated. First, note that the method presented here applies to any collection of discretized or distributed masses. It can equally be used for an automobile or a ship, as well as aircraft. Note that the term collection of masses implies we break the aircraft into constituent components and then somehow figure out the mass or weight and the CG position of each component. Now, say we have a collection of n components and we know their weights and CG positions. Thus, let's call the weight of component 1 W sub 1 and denote its spatial coordinates as x sub 1, y sub 1, and z sub 1. Similarly, the weight of component 2 is w sub 2, and we denote its spatial coordinates as x sub 2, y sub 2, and z sub 2, and so forth. In general, we denote the weight of component I as w sub I, and its spatial coordinates as x sub I, y sub I, and z sub I. We can now calculate the total weight of all the components by simple addition, which we can write in a more compact form as shown. Again, this is the combined weight of all the components involved. Also note that W might represent empty weight or mission takeoff weight, depending on whether we include occupants and fuel with the airframe-related components. This begs the following question. If we know the weight and CG position of each component, can we calculate the center of gravity of the entire collection? Clearly, the answer to the question is yes. And this is how we calculate it. First, we must define the moment of each weight along each of the three axes of the coordinate system, as shown. These products can be considered indicative of the effectiveness of each weight and its distance from the origin. Thus, a light component placed far from the origin of the coordinate axis can exert the same effect as a heavy component closer to the origin. For clarity, let's denote the center of gravity of the collection as x, y, c, where the subscript CG refers to the CG position of the entire collection of components. Now, the sum of the moments of each component must equal the moment developed by the total weight placed at the center of gravity position. Mathematically, we write this as shown. It follows that the position of the center of gravity is found by dividing through by the total weight. For stability and control problems, it is generally necessary to calculate all three components of the center of gravity. However, pilot operations are almost exclusively limited to the x sub c coordinate only. Let's give a short and simple example that only considers the distribution of three components along a massless beam. Of course, I expect you to connect this to an actual airplane where you would have multiple components such as wing, horizontal tail, vertical tail, landing gear, engine, fuselage, avionics, control system, and so on. Let's use the metric system for this example. Here, component 1 has a mass of 100 kilograms and is positioned 3 meters from the origin. The mass of component 2 is 30 kilos and it is positioned 9 meters from the origin. And the mass of component 3 is 10 kilograms and it is positioned 15 meters from the origin. It is not hard to envision that if we placed a hinge point here, the collection would rotate clockwise. Similarly, if we place a hinge point here, the collection would rotate counterclockwise. This means that somewhere between these two points, there must be a point that results in no rotation. This point is the center of gravity. And we have now developed the mathematics that allow us to determine its position precisely, without having to put in a hinge at all. This is how we do it. Step 1. Calculate the total mass. Don't let it bother you that I use W here rather than M for mass. That's just for consistency. Step 2. Calculate the total mass moment. Step 3. Calculate the center of gravity. This means that if we place a hinge point 5.143 meters from the left edge, the beam will be balanced. The equivalent system is shown. Finally, let's do another example, this one hitting a little closer to home. However, I want you to try to solve it on your own, as homework. You can find the solution after the end slide at the end of this video. If you can solve this without any problems, you're ready to tackle most CG estimation problems. Consider the aircraft shown and the associated components. The graph shows their position and weight. The green box shows the intended CG envelope. Determine if the empty weight CG is inside this box. The weights and CG positions of the components are tabulated as shown here. This information should suffice to determine the answer conclusively. Simply pause while you jot down these numbers. Of course, you will find a lot of information about weight and CG analysis in Chapter 6 of my book, including methods to estimate component weights for general aviation aircraft and to calculate moments and products of inertia of your aircraft, something required for dynamic stability and control analysis. I hope this video has shed a little light on how to estimate the position of the center of gravity and other weight and CG-related concepts. If it has helped you in some way, I would be most grateful if you'll consider giving it a thumbs up rating on YouTube. Have fun designing.